And everybody said,
amen.
I welcome all the workers tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And I pray that tonight the Lord will strengthen us more and more.
Amen.
Make us to do better.
Amen.
Make us to run faster.
Amen.
And climb a higher mountain.
Amen.
Are you there?
Yes.
Are you all right?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Father, we thank you for our workers training tonight. Thank you for your people. Thank you because you want to make great, glorious, anointed vessels out of everyone. We're asking, Lord, tonight, everything you want to do in every life, you'll do it and accomplish it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Make us better workers, better leaders. We'll be strong in the way of the Lord in Jesus' name. Anoint your people tonight, that we'll see everything you want us to see and be able to do everything you've called us to do, that this work will prosper in our hands. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're reading from 2 Timothy chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 19. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If any man, if any believer, if any Christian, if any child of God, any worker, any leader, if any man, if a man therefore purge himself from these, it shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared, tell me, unto every good work. You'll find in verse 21 there, it says, if a man therefore purge himself from this, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, and prepared unto every good work. As we look at that word, vessel, you want to understand that Christian workers, Christian preachers, Christian servants, servants of God, are referred to as vessels. We're also referred to as laborers, as well as servants of the Lord. And as vessels, we must be cleansed. As vessels, we must be sanctified. As vessels, we're set apart. As vessels, we're chosen, chosen vessels. Come to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, reading from verse 15. You see what the Lord says about the vessel. A vessel for the Lord, a vessel unto the Lord, a vessel to carry the great treasure of heaven, the anointing from heaven, the unction from heaven, carry to the people. It tells us in Acts of the Apostles chapter 9, verse 15. It says, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me. A chosen vessel unto God. The Lord was referring to Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul the apostle. And the Lord said he had a duty for him, a responsibility for him, an assignment for him, a ministry for him. And to carry out that ministry and to carry out that assignment, it says he is a vessel. A chosen vessel, he says, and he says, to bear my name, to carry my name, to take my name to the Gentiles, before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. And so you understand, when the New Testament talks about the vessel, it's talking about a chosen instrument in the hand of God to take the word, to take the gospel to the people beyond. When you think about a vessel, you think about a container. You think about something that has precious treasure inside. And when we talk about the servant of God, about the vessel, we're talking about the one that has the life-saving gospel, the truth, to declare unto people, heavenly goods to deliver to perishing souls. If the vessels are corroded, then the water inside, the oil inside, and the material inside, the treasure inside, will be contaminated. And so, ungodly lives, that is, contaminated vessels, corroded vessels, rusty vessels, vessels that are not really clean, vessels that are not in the proper position to hold the heavenly treasure in it. And then with false messages, instead of giving life, will kill. Instead of giving life, will destroy. Instead of healing and saving souls, will actually hinder souls from getting saved and getting to heaven. Unclean vessels do not bring honor and glory to God. Let's come back to that. 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 20 here. It says, but in a great house, it's talking about a large church. It's talking about a big family. It's talking about a church with many members and many workers and many leaders and many pastors. It says, but in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and vessels of silver. It says that those who are precious, that those who are clean, that those who are righteous, and there are those who are living up to the mark. But then it says, but also there are vessels of wood, and vessels of earth. And then he says, some to honor, those ones that are clean, those ones that are upright, those ones that allow the free flow of the unction of the Lord to flow through them without any defilement, without any contamination. It says there are some to honor, but it says, unfortunately, there are some to dishonor. And you come to Isaiah chapter 65. Isaiah chapter 65, here we're reading from verse 3. Isaiah chapter 65, and we're reading from verse 3. It tells us here in verse 3, it says, Isaiah chapter 65, verse 3, a people that provoketh me to anger continually to my face. God was talking about the children of Israel. They were supposed to be vessels unto honor. But it says these are people that provoked him to anger continually to his face. And the sacrifice that sacrificeth in gardens and burneth incense upon altars of brick. That is, the incense they were not supposed to burn, and the sacrifices they were not supposed to render or to sacrifice. That's what they did. Look at this, verse 4, which remain among the graves and lodge in the monuments, which eat swine's flesh and broth. Look at this, of abominable things in their vessels. And that makes them unclean, that makes them defiled, that makes them unacceptable. And look at this, look at verse 5. Even with all that abomination, with all that contagion, and with all that defilement, look at what he said in verse 5. Which say, stand ye, stand by thyself, come not near unto me, for I am holier than thou. You see, even though they are abominable vessels, even though they are contaminated vessels, even though they are defiled vessels, they will still say to other people, stand by yourself, I'm clean. Stand by yourself, I'm holy. Stand by yourself, I'm righteous. And yet God said they were provoking him, and they were telling other people, we're better than yourself, we're holier than yourself. Look at the slide. It says, these are a smoke in my nose and a fire that burneth all the day. And so you see what price God puts on clean vessel, righteous vessel, holy vessel, sincere vessel, on hypocritical, humble vessel. You see what he places, what price he places on them. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52, and I'm reading from verse 11. Isaiah chapter 52, reading here from verse 11. Depart ye, depart ye. Go ye out from thence, touch no unclean thing. Go ye out of the midst of her. be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. You see that? He wants us to depart from evil, depart from iniquity, and depart from every form of unrighteousness as we bear the vessel of the Lord. If we do not depart from iniquity, from unrighteousness, then we are vessels that he has no pleasure in. In Jeremiah chapter 22, Jeremiah chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 28, Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 28. Is this man, Coniah, he despised broken idol? You know, it's referring to a man. It says, is this man, Coniah, is he a despised broken idol? What does that mean? You see, Coniah wanted, you know, the people to set attention on him like an idol, like another god, like a little god, like a demigod. And then God said, look at Coniah, it's like a broken idol. His life is not right. He's even competing with the Almighty God, and he wants the worship. He wants the attention, the attention that should be given unto God. Look at this. You see a vessel wherein is no pleasure. A vessel wherein is no pleasure. When we're not righteous, when we're not holy, when we're not upright, and when we're not straightforward, when we're not transparent, we become vessels, vessels that God has no pleasure in. I'm coming to Hosea chapter 8, Hosea chapter 8, and I'm reading here from verse 8. Vessels unto honor and vessels unto dishonor. Vessels that are clean, vessels that are not really clean. We're looking at Hosea chapter 8, and we're looking at verse 8. Israel is swallowed up. Now shall they be among the Gentiles as a vessel wherein is no pleasure. It's talking about Israel, the people of God. But these people of God, they went and mixed with the world. And they went and they mingled with the world. They went and associated with the world. The world came into them, and they came into the world. And it says Israel is swallowed up. You cannot see the distinction anymore. You cannot see the distinct character of an Israelite anymore. You cannot see the uprightness that is different, that is distinguished, that is unique for the children of Israel, because they were now just like all the other people. What the other people were doing, they were doing. What they were eating, they were eating. And there was no distinction between Israel and the Gentiles anymore. They were swallowed up. They were assimilated into the system of the world. It says Israel is swallowed up. Now shall they be among the Gentiles as a vessel wherein is no pleasure. It's telling you and telling me and telling all of us that if we're going to be vessels that God will delight in, we keep that distinction, and we keep that separation, and we keep ourselves under the cleansing of the blood of the Lamb, and we're different from the people of the world. Look at what Israel has done. Look at verse 3. Verse 3, it says, Israel has cast off the sin that is good. The enemy shall pursue him. You see, the enemy could not touch Israel before, because he said, do my prophets no harm. He will not allow anybody to touch them. But now, they forsook the right way, and they forsook the distinction that God had given Israel, and they forsook the law of God he had given to them. So he said, Israel has cast off the sin that is good. The enemy shall pursue him. Look at verse 12. In verse 12 it says, I have reached unto him. It's talking about Israel. It's talking about his people. It's talking about the people. He wanted them to be vessels unto honor, precious gold and precious silver and precious stones, and the people that carry the treasure of the Lord to carry to all the people around them, made themselves different, lifted high, and from that high position then go to deliver the goods from heaven unto the people. But you see what he did in verse 12. I have reached unto him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a strange thing. The doctrines of the Bible became strange unto them, and the stand of the Lord became strange unto them, and the things the Lord wanted to carry as treasure and give to the people became strange unto them. And God said, because of that, they mixed themselves with the heathens, were the pagans, were the unbelievers, they now became vessels in which there was no pleasure. We're coming to Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 23. Romans chapter 2, I read from verse 23. In Romans chapter 2, verse 23, look at what it says over here. It says, thou that makest the boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God. Those are vessels that dishonored God. Vessels in which God had no pleasure because they were bearing the law. They were bearing the word of God, and yet through them other people were blaspheming the name of the Lord because they were not keeping to that law. Look at verse 24. For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. Our vessels will be clean. Your vessel will be holy. And look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. The way he wants us to keep our vessel, keep our body, keep our mind, keep our soul, keep our spirit, keep our personality, and keep our lives and keep our ministry, so that our lives, our ministry, our personality, and everything we do will bring glory to God, will bring honor to God, will be vessels unto honor. We're coming to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Look at verse 3. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. Look at this, look at this. Verse 4. That every one of you, how many of us? Are you here? Are you included? Let me hear you. It says in verse 4 that every one of you should know how to possess what? His vessel in sanctification and honor. Those who are children of God, those who are believers, and those who are workers, and those who say the name of Christ, it says that you should know how to possess your vessel. Your vessel, everything within you that contains this treasure that comes from heaven. Your heart, your soul, your spirit, your mind, your body, your tongue, your ears, your eyes, your personality, that you will know how to possess everything in sanctification and honor. Tonight, we're looking at the message, the uniqueness and usefulness of God honoring vessels. The uniqueness. Vessels of God, vessels appointed by God, and vessels appointed for God are unique. They're distinct. They're different. They're not like every Dick and Harry. And they're not like every person you see on the street. The uniqueness and then the usefulness. Because he appoints us. Because he raises us up. Because he's training us. Because he gives the word of reconciliation, the word of ministry, the message. He gives it to us. He wants us to carry that to the world around us. That's what makes us useful. And then we honor God. We're God honoring vessels. The message tonight, the uniqueness and the usefulness of God honoring vessels. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, the distinctive features of consecrated vessels. The distinctive features, the distinctive marks, the distinctive characteristics, and the distinctive nature of vessels that are consecrated. The distinctive features of consecrated vessels. Point number two, the distinguished fruits of compliant vessels. Compliant vessels, not contradictory vessels, not vessels in conflict with other people, but those who are compliant, those who are submissive, those who are yielded, and those who comply with everything the Lord is giving unto us. It says, we're compliant like that, obedient like that, then we will bear fruit. You will bear fruit. The distinguished fruits of compliant vessels. Point number three, the determined favor, the destined favor, the declared favor, the favor that God declares on commendable vessels. The determined favor, for commendable vessels, for commendable vessels. Point number one, tell me your number one over there. The distinctive features of consecrated vessels. We're coming back to 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, we're reading from verse 19. We're looking at the features of vessels that are consecrated to God, consecrated to the service of God, consecrated to the calling of God, consecrated to the ministry that God has put in their hands. The features, the characteristics, the marks. Look at this from verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. Number one, conversion. Conversion. A consecrated vessel must have gone through conversion. It no longer belongs to the world. It belongs to the Lord. It no longer belongs to Satan. It belongs to the Lord. It no longer belongs even to the human family, to the earthly family. It belongs to the Lord. It says, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Conversion is the number one thing. There must be that change. There must be that conversion if we're going to be vessels unto honor in the sight of the Lord. We're coming to Matthew chapter 18, verse 3. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3. And said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, innocent as little children, tender as little children, teachable as little children, submissive as little children, humble as little children, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. If a person is not going to enter the kingdom of heaven, how can he bring other people to enter? He's not inside himself. He doesn't know to get in himself. There must be conversion before you can be a chosen vessel in the hand of the Lord. Look at verse 4. Verse 4. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Come back to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. It says that the Lord knoweth who are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from, tell me, from iniquity. Everyone that nameth the name of Christ. The little convert, the little baby in Christ, he mentions the name of Christ in prayer. And the soul winner mentions the name of Christ in prayer. As we go out and we're witnessing for Christ and witnessing to Christ, we mention the name of Christ. As we preach over the pulpit, preachers and pastors, we mention the name of Christ. And he says, let everyone, from young to the old, from the young to the old, let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That's what he calls us to do. We must depart from iniquity. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 52 once again. Isaiah chapter 52, and here we're reading from verse 11. It's a command. It's an imperative. It's what he wants. It's what he desires, and it is what he demands from everyone that names the name of Christ. And these are the characteristics of the vessels that are yielded to the Lord, committed to the Lord, consecrated unto the Lord. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 11, depart ye, depart ye, depart ye, depart ye, is said a double time there. Go ye out from things, that is out of the world, out of the pollutions of the world, and out of all the degradations and defilement of the world. Touch no unclean thing. Don't even touch it. Don't even go near it. Don't let it come near you. Don't let a resemblance of the things and the sins and the evil of the world be part of your life. Touch no unclean thing. Go ye out from the midst of her, and be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. We're coming back to 2 Timothy chapter 2. And I'm reading here now from verse 20. The distinctive marks and features of consecrated vessels. Number one, they are converted. Number two, they depart from all iniquity. Number three, They are precious. They are precious. Look at this in verse 20. Verse 20. It tells us in verse 20. It says in verse 20, but in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, some to honor and some to dishonor. As we look at that verse, the verse is divided into two parts. It says there are vessels of gold, some to honor. There are vessels of silver, some to honor. Then it says, on the other hand, there are those that are not precious, they are not worthy, they are not weighty, they are not essential, they are not important. They don't carry the unction from heaven, and they don't take it as something, you know, that is very precious to go and deliver unto the people they are ministering to. They are vessels of wood, and they are vessels of earth, clay. And it says there are to dishonor. But you see, if we're going to bear the precious ointment, we must be precious. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, precious, precious instrument of God, precious vessels unto the Lord. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'm reading here from verse 9, for we are laborers together with God. Any laborer for God there? I said any laborer for God there? We are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. Look at this. According to the grace which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let everyone, every man, take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For the foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, tell me, precious stones, you see, those are the ones unto honor. Gold, silver, precious stone. Then look at the others, not the ones to dishonor. Wood, hay, stubble. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what it is. Precious. We're coming to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. To be a vessel unto honor. A chosen vessel, a cleansed vessel, a pure vessel, a prepared vessel, a vessel that carries the great ointment from on high to the people here on earth. Here's what must happen. We're looking at 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 1. Wherefore, laying aside, how many kinds of malice? What do you do with malice? Nurse them, accept them. I said, what do you do with malice? Swallow them up. Think about them. Act on them. Behave with malice. What shall we do? Lay aside. And he says, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies, plural, and envies, plural, and all evil speakings. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that he may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming, look at this, as unto living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God, and tell me, precious. That's what he wants it to be. That's what he wants me to be. He is precious. And if we're going to carry his message, if we're going to carry his ministry to the people who are waiting for that ministry, we ourselves must be precious. Ye also, in verse 5, as lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Look at verse 9. In verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, distinctive features, very different and distinguished from the people of the world, very different from the people in the world who do not have salvation. people of the world who do not know about holiness. And it says here, we're peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We're coming back to 2 Timothy. I'm reading here from chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I read from verse 21. It says, if a man therefore purge himself from these, he wants to be a vessel unto honor. He purges himself. He wants to be highly valued by the Lord. He purges himself. He wants to be at the cutting edge of real successful ministry for the Lord. Therefore, he purges himself. If a man therefore purge himself from these, from what? What does he purge himself from? So that he can be a vessel unto honor. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I read from verse 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 7. It tells us in verse 7, purge out therefore the old leaven, old character, old behavior, old attitude, old habits, old disposition. Purge out therefore the old leaven, that she may be a new lump, as she are unleavened. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast not with the old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I pray the Lord will purge every one of us. We'll come back to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified. That's another characteristic. If you're going to be a distinguished kind of a vessel, consecrated to the Lord, yielded to the Lord, it says, number one, purged. Number two, sanctified. Sanctified. In Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Reading from verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5. Verse 25. It tells us in verse 25, husbands, love your wives. Amen. Husbands, we are talking to husbands now. Husbands, love your wives. Ah, there's a problem in some places. Husbands, love your wives. Amen. Amen. And wives, love your husbands. Amen. Wonderful. Look at verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might do what? Sanctify. You see, there are people, I'm a worker, are you sanctified? I'm a worker, are you converted? I'm a worker, are you purged? I'm a worker, are you precious? I'm a worker, have you departed from all iniquity? Are you sanctified? It says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, glorious members, glorious ministers, glorious sons and daughters will make up a glorious church. Defiled sons and daughters will make up a defiled church. Compromising sons and daughters will make up a compromising church. And dishonoring sons and daughters will make up a dishonoring church. But when the members are sanctified, when the workers are sanctified, when the leaders are sanctified, when the men and the women are sanctified, then you say that my present to himself a glorious church, not having spot, not having wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Amen. Amen. All blemish will go away. Amen. Unholiness will go away. Unrighteousness will go away. Distinctive features, number one, conversion. Number two, departure from iniquity. Number three, you are priceless and precious. Number four, there is poaching. Number five, there is sanctification. Number six, prepared. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and made for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. Prepared unto every good work. Whatever area of work you're involved in, you're prepared to do good. This section where you are, you're prepared to do good. You are adding something of value and something of worth and something, you know, that is commendable into the work of the Lord. Prepared, prepared. Look at Ezra chapter 7. Ezra chapter 7. This is what the Lord expects of us. We cannot just dabble into the work of God, jump into the word of God. We cannot just dive into the word of God and into the ministry of the word without being prepared. Our hearts are prepared. Our minds are prepared. Our message prepared. And our family is prepared. Everything we do, there is a preparation so that we'll be qualified for the ministry. Look at Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. For Ezra had prepared his heart. His heart. We go beyond the notes we write, the references we're going to quote. We go beyond the doctrines we're going to teach. We prepare our hearts. Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it. And to do it. Not just a preacher. Do as I say, but don't do as I do. To do it. It's not just a person that says, I know the doctrine, I know the Bible, I know the word of God, and I'm giving it to you. Don't look at my life. Don't look at whatever I do. No, it's not like that. It's Ezra prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach in Israel statutes and judgment. I pray that all of us will be well prepared in Jesus' name. We're coming back to 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading now from verse 22. Reading from verse 22. It says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. And this one, number 7, is thoroughly cleansed. Thoroughly cleansed. Now he's so cleansed that there is no remnant of unrighteousness in him. No remnant of defilement in him. No remnant of iniquity in him. Look at what's in his life. He's following after righteousness, following after faith, following after charity, love, following after peace. And it says, with them that call on the name of the Lord out of a pure heart. In the past, he had maybe unrighteousness and sin and evil sins. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But now he is thoroughly cleansed. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Don't deceive yourself. And don't let any false preacher deceive you. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor the effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. But thank God we are washed. Thank God we are cleansed. Thoroughly cleansed. Look at verse 11. And such was some of you, but ye are washed. But ye are sanctified. But ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. And the cleansing should be visible. The cleansing should be practical. And the people that know you should know that you have been cleansed, you have been washed, thoroughly cleansed. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 9. It says, but they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Somebody is a worker. In fact, somebody is a Christian. somebody who is a believer, somebody who is a pilgrim on his way to heaven, will not allow himself to be sucked up, swallowed up by the snare and the lust and the foolishness of the world, running after this and running after that. Look at this in verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith, and they have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Verse 11, but thou, O man of God, are they in the house? O women of God, are they in the house tonight? It says, but thou, O man of God, O child of God, woman of God, man of God, it says, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. The good fight of faith. Don't fight the bad fight of old character, but the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. And now we'll come back to 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from the first part of verse 22. Flee also youthful lusts. Flee also youthful lusts. It's telling us here, it's not only talking to youths, it's saying that these lusts are peculiar to youth. And as you are growing old and growing older, you may still find that those youthful lusts, they are still quite, they could be a problem. And those youthful lusts that, you experience at 17, at 23, at 25, at 33, the youthful lusts might still be there. The old character and the old temptation of those times when you were young, they may still be knocking at the door. Flee youthful lusts. And then it says in verse 23, but foolish and unlearned questions avoid. Foolish and unlearned discussions avoid. Foolish and unlearned investigation avoid. Foolish and unlearned curiosity avoid. And it says, knowing that they do gender strive. The gender strive. And it's the life of a real child of God. He abstains from anything that will pull him, that will pull her, back into the degradation, defilement of the world. We're reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. Temptation, abstain from all appearance of evil. Youthful lusts, abstain from all appearance of evil. Anything that smells like is coming from the devil's kitchen, avoid all that. Anything that looks like is coming from the domain of Satan, avoid that. Anything that smells of hell, that smells of brimstone and fire, that smells of defilement that will drag somebody into eternal perdition, avoid. Abstain from all appearance of evil. The point there is abstaining. You all abstain. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 20. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20. O Timothy, O man of God, O woman of God, O Timothy, O preacher, O pastor, O shepherd, O teacher of the word, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding. There's something to avoid. There's something to avoid. You don't just see, sin and then rush into that. Temptation and rush into that. Evil and rush into that. And unbelief and rush into that. And unbelievers peddling and selling their commodities. And then you run into that. To Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. If you have something of value, the doctrines of the word of God, keep that. And if you have this precious gospel, keep that. If you have the ministry, keep that. If what the Lord has given to you is precious to you, and you know that God has counted you worthy to give that precious thing unto you and to have that treasure in the earthen vessel, then keep that. Keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, arguments of science, falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. I said, grace be with you. We're coming back to 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 24. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24. The distinctive features of consecrated vessels. Those who are consecrated to the Lord. And you understand that you are not just a minister during the service. If you're a minister, you're a minister all the time. If you're a minister, you're a minister 24 hours of the day and every day of the week. And you're a minister, if you're a minister, if you're a real Christian worker, you're a Christian worker in your family. You're a Christian worker, even if you're not preaching to your family, a man is a man morning, afternoon, and evening. A man is a man, whether it's on Monday or Tuesday or Saturday or Sunday, the same thing. A Christian worker, a Christian leader, a Christian pastor, a Christian preacher is a leader all the time. And so you demonstrate the character of the real minister of God anywhere and everywhere you find yourself. Hey, look at verse 24 now. It says, the servant of the Lord must not strive. Amen?
Amen.
You're not fight in your office. You're not strive on the road. You're not strive in the bus. You're not strive in the church. You're not strive in your family. You'll not demonstrate anger and then malice and all those evil things. You'll never, if you are a real minister, servant of God, morning, afternoon, and evening, at home and in the church, anywhere, with anyone, whatever the provocation. It says the servant of the Lord must not strive. But be gentle to how many people? Gentle to tell me how many people? If you are there, I say gentle to how many people? All men, apt to teach, patient. This characteristic is gentleness and patience. We're looking at James chapter 3, James chapter 3, and I'm reading here from verse 17. James chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 17. James chapter 3, verse 17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable. What's the next word there? Gentle. Gentle. You know, there are some people that say they are wise, they have wisdom, and their wisdom takes gentleness away from them. Their wisdom takes away meekness from them. Their wisdom takes away obedience to the word of God from them. Their wisdom takes away being a vessel unto honor away from them. It says, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Amen.
Amen.
Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 14. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 14. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient towards all men. Be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man. He did evil to me, I'm going to retaliate. I'm going to pay him back in the coin he had given to me. It says, see that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the Spirit. Capital S, the Spirit of love. Quench not the Spirit. The Spirit with anointing. Quench not the Spirit. The Spirit of prayer. Quench not the Spirit. The Spirit of intercession. Quench not the Spirit. The Spirit of reconciliation. Quench not the Spirit. Despise not prophesying. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Abstain from, tell me, all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. You will do it. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 25. 2 Timothy chapter 2. And we're reading from verse 25. It's still talking about the features of consecrated vessels. It tells us here in chapter 2, verse 25, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. In meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. There are people that oppose their own salvation. You know that. You instruct them in meekness. Don't fight with them. You want to get somebody saved, and then you have to take a hammer and beat him and beat out there. You don't do that. In meekness, instructing those that oppose their own sanctification. They are hindering their own sanctification, but in meekness, you instruct them. In meekness, instructing those that oppose their own progress. You're meek with them. You're gentle with them. That's the characteristic, the feature of a real servant of God who is a consecrated vessel. You see those unbelievers, you see those backsliders, the things they do is to hinder the word of salvation coming to them, and the word of sanctification coming to them, and the word of life eternal coming to them. They don't understand they are hindering themselves from getting to heaven, and you understand. Therefore, you instruct them with meekness, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. If peradventure God will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. The point there is that you are teachable and restorable. Teachable and restorable, as well as meek. You are meek and you are instructive. Verse 26, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. What are the distinctive features of consecrated vessels? Number one, they're converted. Number two, they depart from iniquity. Number three, they're precious. Number four, they're purged. Number five, they're sanctified. Number six, they're prepared unto every good work. Number seven, they're thoroughly cleansed. Number eight, they abstain from even the appearance of evil. Number nine, they're gentle and patient. Number 10, they're meek and instructive. And number 11, they're teachable and restorable. Restorable. What that means is that they give allowance for themselves to be restored. There are people who backslide. There are people who go astray, and they close the door to restoration. They are not restorable. They shut the door against anyone that will try to help them and restore them. But the characteristic of a real child of God, even though he might have gone astray or made a mistake, he is teachable and restorable. Number 12, faithful and committed. Faithful and committed. We're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 2. It says, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, faithful men, faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. That's the characteristic of a real child of God, of a real minister of the gospel. He is faithful. Look at verse 3 there. In verse 3 it says, thou therefore endure hardness. Challenges will come in the ministry. Difficulties may come in the ministry. Therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that worries entangles himself with the affairs of this life, with the affairs of a worldliness, that she may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. I pray it will be consecrated, committed, precious, clean, qualified vessels in Jesus' name. Point number two now, the distinguished fruits of compliant vessels. compliant vessels. We're coming to Jeremiah chapter 18. Jeremiah chapter 18. And here we're reading from verse 1, compliant vessels. That's what compliant means. You comply. You comply. The word of God is there. We cannot change the word of God. Whatever others do, however others act, whatever it is, you have decided that you're going to be a compliant vessel. Therefore, you comply with the word of God. That's what compliant means. You are cooperating. You are cooperating. You are not kind of aggressively contradictory to the ministry. Aggressively contradictory to the word of God. You are hearing, you are compliant, you comply, you are compliant, you are cooperate, you are submissive. That's what it means, that you are compliant. You are easily, you are easy to relate with, and you are easy to direct and easy to teach. You are submissive. It means you're obedient. To be compliant, you cannot be compliant and disobedient at the same time. You respect the word of God, you accept the word of God, and you know that this the way, walk ye therein. You are compliant, you're obedient. It means you are consenting. You consent to the word of God. When you are compliant, you consent. You say, yes, I know that's the word of God. I can read that with you. That's the word of God. I know that's the requirement from God. I can read that. You consent. You are agreeable. If you are compliant, you are agreeable. I don't accept that. I don't take that. I don't receive that. I don't sign to that. I read it in the Bible. I don't want that. You're not like that. If you are compliant, a compliant vessel is an agreeable vessel. And then you're yielding. You yield to the word of God. You bend to the word of God. You don't want to bend to the word of God. You don't want to alter the word of God. You don't want to change the word of God. You are yielding and you are united with the people of God. And that's what it means to be compliant. Compliant servants of God. Compliant workers in the kingdom. Compliant vessels in the kingdom. Look at Jeremiah chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 1. Jeremiah chapter 18. And I'm reading here from verse 1. Here it says, and the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will speak, I will cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down. He himself was compliant. He himself was teachable. He himself was agreeable. The Lord told him immediately. Then he went. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. Look at verse 4. And the vessel, we're talking about the vessel, compliant, agreeable, amenable. A person that is yielded to the Lord, and the vessel that he made was of clay, was marred, was distorted in the hand of the potter. So he made it again, another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make it, as it seemed good unto him. You're not judging the potter. You're not criticizing the potter. You're not finding another venue for the potter. You're not saying, potter, why don't you do this? Why don't you do it this way? He was agreeable. And that's the kind of vessel he wants us to be, that he will fashion us the way it pleases him. We're coming to Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, verse 15. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel. When God chooses somebody, he doesn't want that person to compete with him, to contradict him. He doesn't want that person to all the time try to correct the Almighty God, because he thinks he has more knowledge, more than the Almighty God. He's a chosen vessel. If he's a chosen vessel, he must be a compliant vessel. He says unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and to the children of Israel. Look at the result and look at the response of Paul as a result of being a chosen vessel, compliant in the hand of the Lord. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, First Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 4. But as we were allowed of God, he said it's not our right, we're allowed of God, we're permitted of God, we're favored by God. And God just brought us into this. We didn't work for this, we didn't pay for this. He says we're allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel. Even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God which tries our hearts. That's a compliant vessel. A person that says, God chose me, and God called me, and God put me in place, and I'm going to be faithful to him to please the Lord. Look at chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 1. Furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us, how ye ought to walk and to please God. You have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God. That should be in your thought every time, your consideration every time. How can I do this work to please God? How can I do this ministry to please God? How can I go that errand to please God? How can I carry out this to please God? How can I do the work he has committed into my hands to please God? So ye will abound more and more. I pray we'll abound more and more in Jesus' name. You remember when I was explaining the word compliant, I mentioned the word yield. Yield. You're yielding, you're obedient unto the Lord. You're not difficult to direct. You're not difficult to control. You're not difficult to lead. You yield. We're looking at Romans chapter 6, verse 19. Romans chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 19. It says, I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. That as she have, this is the word, as she have yielded your members, servants, to unrighteousness in the past, uncleanness in the past, and to iniquity in the past, unto iniquity, even so now yield your members. Do it voluntarily, do it cheerfully, do it happily, do it without complaining. Yield your members, servants, to righteousness and to holiness. When we do that, our ministry will yield fruit. If you yield to the Lord, then whatever he has committed into your hand will bear fruit. Look at Psalm 85. I'm reading from verse 11. Psalm 85, reading from verse 11. 85, verse 11. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good, and our land, what will the land do? Yield her increase. Our land will yield her increase. Righteousness shall go before him and shall set us in the way of his steps. Psalm 107. In Psalm 107, when we yield to the Lord, when you are compliant, when you're obedient, when you're submissive, when you're teachable, when you're easy to lead and you yield, then your ministry will yield fruit. We're looking at Psalm 107 and we're looking at verse 32. Let them exalt him also in the congregation of the people. You come to minister to the congregation, exalt the Lord. You're the means of the people of God. Forget yourself and forget your whatever it is, and think about the Lord. And it says, exalt him in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. It tells us in verse 36, and there he maketh the hungry to dwell, that they may prepare a city for habitation. And so the fields and plant vineyards which may yield fruits of increase. When you honor the Lord in your ministry, and when you honor the Lord in what he has committed in your hand, it says, then you will yield fruit. Your ministry will bear fruit. Ezekiel chapter 34. Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 26 and 27. Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 26 and 27. And I will make them and the places round about my hill a blessing. And I will cause the shower to come down in a season, and there shall be showers of blessing. And the tree of the field shall yield her fruit. When we yield to the Lord, when we submit to the Lord and surrender to the Lord, then it says, the tree of the field shall yield her fruit, and the earth shall yield her increase. The work of God will increase in your hand. And they shall be saved in their land, and shall know that I am the Lord when I have broken the bands of their yoke. Your yokes are broken. And delivered them out of the hand of those that serve themselves of them. In Ezekiel chapter 36, I'm reading from verse 8. Ezekiel 36, verse 8. But ye, O mountains of Israel, ye shall shoot forth your branches and yield your fruit to my people of Israel, for they are at hand to come. For behold, I am for you, and I will turn unto you, and ye shall be tilled and sown, and I will multiply men upon you, all the house of Israel, even all of it, and the city shall be inhabited, and the waste places shall be builded, and I will multiply upon you man and beast, and they shall increase and bring forth fruit, and I will settle you after your old estates, and will do better unto you than at your beginnings, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. You see, when we yield to the Lord, that's what he said he will do. You yield to the Lord, and then you'll bear more fruit. Increase in the work of your hand. Increase in your ministry. Jeremiah chapter 17, we're looking at verse 7. Jeremiah chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 7. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when the heat cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful, shall not be anxious in the year of drought, neither shall cease yielding fruit. You will not stop yielding fruit. You'll keep on yielding fruit in Jesus' name. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 22. Joel chapter 2, verse 22. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring.